The Neruda Case by Roberto Ampuero. Translated by Carolina de Robertis. Narrated by Robertson Dean. Copyright 2012 by Roberto Ampuero. Translation copyright 2012 by Carolina de Robertis. This unabridged audiobook is recorded by arrangement with Riverhead Books, a member of Penguin Group USA Incorporated, and was produced in the year 2012 by Tantor Media Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto.
I ask you, where is my child?
Pablo Neruda, The Prodigal, from the Captain's Verses. Josie. 1. What could be bothering the partners of Almagro Ruggiero and Associates, who had asked him to appear at their headquarters in such a hurry? Cayetano Brule wondered, one warm February morning, as he left his office in the attic of the Turi building, in the heart of Valparaiso's financial district, and took the elevator down to Pratt Street. Ever since democracy was restored, ARNA had become the most influential consulting firm in the country, and it was rumored that no stipulation or public litigation of any importance could pass without its sanction. Its tentacles spanned from the presidential palace to the neo-Gothic headquarters of businessmen, and from Congress to the National Comptroller's Office, passing through ministries, political parties, embassies, and courts. Its attorneys could not only obtain laws and decrees, subsidies and pardons, exemptions and amnesties, but also wash away disgrace and polish the prestige of public figures down on their luck. ARNA operated in corridors and behind the scenes, and though its top executives attended key receptions and dinners in the capital, its proprietors were essentially invisible and rarely attended social gatherings or granted interviews to the press. But when they did decide to appear on the great stage of the nation's political and business affairs, they glowed in their Italian suits and silk ties, with their triumphant smiles and cosmopolitan manners as they cryptically offered opinions on various matters, like the oracle at Delphi. When Cayetano lifted his gaze along the buildings on Pratt Street, the Turi clock marked 11:45 as its bells pealed mournfully and seagulls soared and cawed under the crystalline sky. He thought of the birds, the Alfred Hitchcock movie he'd seen in a Sunday matinee at the Maori Theater, before diving into the everyday din, whistling, keeping a steady pace. At Plaza Anibal Pinto, a rumbling in his gut made him stop at the Café del Poeta. It wouldn't matter if he spent a few minutes there. The big bosses at ARNA wouldn't be upset if he was late. On the contrary, in their nervous state, they'd imagine other clients were in need of his services, he thought, as the aroma of roasted coffee slid through his Pancho Villa-style mustache. Many things delighted him about this place, aside from the coffee with the dash of milk and, of course, the sandwiches, the old polished floorboards, the display of porcelain English tea sets in the window, the oil paintings with port motifs, and the cozy light of the bronze lamps. He preferred the table by the entrance, from which he could contemplate the 100-year-old palms in the plaza and the statue of Neptune, seated amid the rocks and the multicolored fish of a fountain, as well as the cemetery at the top of Carcel Hill, a capricious graveyard that, in every earthquake, spewed an avalanche of mausoleum bricks, wooden crosses, and ramshackle coffins full of cadavers down into the center of the city. From that table, he could also watch the imported trolleys, second-hand from Zurich, as they circulated from place to place with their original German signage, as if they were still running past the plain facades of silent Helvetian neighborhoods and had never disembarked to find the potholes, stray dogs, papers, and street vendors of Valparaiso. In any case, the illustrious Almagro and Ruggiero would have to be patient, Cayetano Brule concluded as he adjusted the knot of his tie, which was bright purple with little green guanacos, and waited for the waitress, a pale goth girl with jet-black hair and black clothing who wore a Kanye West-style headset to communicate with the kitchen. He unfolded the local newspaper and read on the front page about the defeat of the long-suffering soccer team, the Wanderers, the slashed throat of a model in the gardens of the Viña del Mar casino, and the alarming rise of unemployment in the region. This last piece of information didn't surprise him. The decline of Valparaiso was no secret. In the 19th century, it had been the most important and prosperous port on the Pacific. Enrico Caruso and Sarah Bernhardt acted in its theaters. Gatti Chavez and exclusive European boutiques opened along its streets, and a quarter of its population, being foreign, spoke no Spanish. But a ferocious earthquake on the night of August 16, 1906, devastated the city and buried more than 3,000 of its inhabitants under the rubble of buildings, houses, and mansions, all in a matter of seconds. That same night, thousands of people abandoned the city for good, and those who remained began, from that moment on, to live by evoking the splendor and glitter of the past, the beauty of the disappeared city, convinced that in some not too distant future, a miracle would restore the march of progress. But just one day short of 8 years later, that same progress dealt them another brutal blow, the opening of the Panama Canal, which was celebrated on August 15, 1914, and strangled Valparaiso. The bay became desolate overnight. The warehouses in the port went empty, the cranes stood still on the wharf, and the bars, shops, and restaurants closed their doors forever, casting employees, whores, and pimps into permanent unemployment. Without any knowledge of this tragic history, of this unending decline, which seemed more like a deliberate divine punishment than the result of random fate, and captivated by the delirious architecture and topography of the city and the affable and taciturn nature of its inhabitants, Cayetano decided to settle in Valparaiso when he arrived in Chile in 1971 on the arm of Maria Paz Angela Undaraga Cox, his wife at the time. Those were the days of Salvador Allende and Unidad Popular, as well as of an unbridled social turmoil that would lead not to what the people dreamed of, but rather to the dictatorship of Augusto Pinochet. How many years had passed since then? Since the start of that period that so many preferred to forget? 30-odd years? In any case, the people of this port city, or porteños, ever dignified, and he now considered himself one of them, believed that good and bad luck crouched, waiting around any corner or just beyond the curve of some stone staircase, and for that reason everything in the world was relative and fleeting. For porteños, accustomed to climbing and descending hills, existence was like their city. At times one soared joyfully, trusting the wave's crest, and at times one lay depressed and unmoving in the depths of a ravine. One could always rise or fall. Nothing was certain. Nothing was forever. No circumstance was permanent. With existence came uncertainty, and only death had no room for change. For that reason, and because he was an incorrigible optimist as long as he didn't want for bread and coffee, as well as an occasional cold beer or glass of rum, and despite the fact that work opportunities were scarce for a private investigator in this city at the end of the earth, which had now become a respectable exporter of fruit, wine, and salmon, and where more and more families were acquiring second cars, vacationing in Havana and Miami, or getting into limitless debt, he didn't mind making the owners of ARNA wait. 16 years earlier, in 1990, the Chilean people had regained democracy through peaceful protests, and now, in this supposedly gray and conservative country, where not too long before divorce was illegal, the president was a divorced woman, a single mother, and a socialist, not to mention an atheist. President Bachelet was a clear sign that this stiletto of land, which extended from the Atacama Desert, the most arid and inhospitable one on the planet, to the South Pole, and which balanced between the fierce waves of the Pacific and the eternal snows of the Andes, always on the brink of collapsing with all its people and goods into the ocean's depths, was a unique place, inimitable and changing, that swung vertiginously from euphoria to depression, or from solidarity to individualism, like one of those complicated hieroglyphs from the archaeologist Heinrich Schliemann that no one could entirely decipher, and that one loved or hated depending on the circumstances, changes in mood, or color of the season. Here no one dies forever, Cayetano mused, as from his table he glimpsed the whitewashed niches, gleaming like the salt flats of Atacama in the cemetery on Carcel Hill. At the first earthquake, they'll return in a flash to the realm of the living.
What can I get you, sir?
The Goth asked him. He requested a double espresso with a dash of milk and the sandwich menu, which he awaited anxiously, preening the ends of his mustache. Now, he recalled it with precision. He had landed in Valparaiso 35 years before, after disembarking from the LAN Boeing in Santiago with Angela, a rather aristocratic Chilean with revolutionary convictions who was studying at an exclusive women's college in the United States. One night, as they made love beneath the coconut palms on the still warm sand of a beach in Cayo Hueso, she had persuaded him to join the movement for socialism as led by Salvador Allende in the Southern Cone. Both experiences, with Allende and with love, had ended for good in an abrupt and calamitous way with Pinochet's coup on September 11, 1973. She sought refuge as an exile in Paris with the charango player of a folk band while he ran aground like an old barge in Chile. He had to hide from the leftists, who spurned him as a Miami gusano, and the right-wingers, who spurned him as an infiltrating Castro supporter. During the dictatorship, he was forced to try his luck at various jobs. He sold books and insurance, promoted Avon beauty creams, and was an assistant for a judicial receiver, traversing the steepest and most dangerous hills of Valparaiso on foot, delivering notices to individuals such as petty thieves, black market merchants, or smugglers. The title of detective, bestowed by a shady distance learning institute in Miami, would later save his life, as it would attract people who wished to task him with minor investigations, such as tracking a loose woman, the theft of a day's earnings from a soda fountain, or death threats from an aggressive neighbor, which allowed him not just to survive with a certain dignity, but also to ply a trade that better fit the independent, fun-loving spirit of a dreamer like him. "Here you go," the goth announced as she unfolded a menu containing full-color photos of the sandwiches and pastries served at the cafe. The menu aimed not only to whet the customer's appetite, but also to give a sense of culture, as it tried to describe the marvelous history of that city with seven lives, known as the Jewel of the Pacific. Strictly speaking, the gem in question was quite worn down. It had not been founded by any official authority, civil or ecclesiastical, and now had 500,000 long-suffering inhabitants in its 50 teeming anarchic hills. A horseshoe bay formed a dazzling amphitheater, and people risked their lives on shabby post-war trolleys and a handful of whining cable cars each time they rode to work or to homes with crumbling balconies and gardens that settled gracefully on peaks or clung precariously to hillsides. Declared a World Heritage Site by UNESCO in honor of its architecture and topography, Valparaiso now began, once again, to show signs of recovery, thanks to retired North Americans and Europeans who, dressed like adolescents and with pockets full of dollars and euros, disembarked en masse from cruise ships that arrived every day during the summer. It wasn't a bad life in Valparaiso, he thought with satisfaction. He rented a yellow house in a neo-Victorian style on Garrisoni Avenue on Concepcion Hill, and from there he could gaze at the Pacific, and on warm and pristine summer mornings even imagine he was in Havana, frolicking in the currents of the Gulf, with the Malecon breeze at his back. In his work as a private investigator, he had the help of a man named Suzuki, a porteño of Japanese origin, who spent his nights attending to the kamikaze, a modest, tiny fried food stall that he owned. It was in the port district, between the plazas Aduana and Matriz, on a narrow street lined with cobblestones and bars, which allowed him to stay abreast of the murmurs of whores and their pimps, who now again enjoyed, along with pickpockets and muggers, the generous fruits of tourism. Though already in his 50s, Cayetano still believed he might one day find the woman of his dreams and become the father of a little boy or girl, it didn't matter which, as long as the child was healthy, before going completely bald and becoming an arthritic, cantankerous retiree. And if in the beginning it had been hard for him to adapt to the severity of Chileans and the rigorous climate of its mountainous land, now the island of Cuba, its people, and its weather were more of a pale and distant evocation, because his new homeland, with all its light and shadows, had ended up conquering him, despite the fact that it was neither green nor an island, unless perhaps it was, just in a different way. "Have you decided what to eat?" the goth asked as she served his coffee. She had translucent arms, riddled with thick blue veins. "A baros luco with extra avocado," he said, and tried to imagine what it would be like to glide his fingertip along those blue lines until he reached her perfumed, hidden slopes. And it was after he had sweetened his drink and tasted it that his gaze fell upon the back of the menu, with its photo of Pablo Neruda on a sofa in his Valparaiso home. He felt his heart freeze, sipping espresso slowly until the lenses of his glasses steamed up, and smiled faintly. It suddenly seemed that the palms, the crosses of the mausoleums on the summit, and even Neptune himself had begun to vibrate like mirages in the desert. His memory transported him to that winter morning in 1973 when he began his first investigation, which he never disclosed to anyone, as it was the most closely guarded secret of his life. The secret he'd still carry as they took him up the hill feet first to that cemetery where the dead, on warm summer nights, swung their hips joyfully to the rhythm of tangos, cumbias, and boleros, longing for the next earthquake to hurl them back down to the picturesque and winding streets of Valparaiso. He closed his eyes and felt his surroundings begin to fade away. The growling of engines, the songs of blind men accompanied by accordions and player pianos, even the shouts of grocers selling herbs, avocados, and lottery tickets with guaranteed prizes. And suddenly, there appeared before him, as if by some magic trick and with prodigious clarity, the coarse, rustic texture of the wooden door on Collado Way. 2. The door was made of knotted wood. It didn't open. He stroked the old bronze knocker, put his hands in the pockets of his fleece jacket, and told himself that all he could do now was wait. He exhaled wafts of white breath into the overcast winter morning and thought, amused, that it looked as if he were smoking, even though in this city there were no more matches or cigarettes. He had just whiled away an hour at Ali Baba, a soda fountain around the corner on Alemania Avenue, across from the Maori Theater. There, he'd read Omar Saavedra Santis's column in El Popular and Enrique Lira Masi's in Puro Chile, while Haddad the Turk made him coffee and a gyro and cursed the food shortages, the queues, and the disorder on the streets, terrified that political friction would tear the country apart and throw him in the garbage can. When Cayetano looked at his watch again, it was past 10 o'clock. Perhaps he hasn't yet returned from the capital, he thought, glancing at the bay, half covered in mist. He had met the man he was about to see a few days earlier, during a party serving coranto a la olla, a seafood specialty from the southern island of Chiloé, in the home of the mayor of Valparaiso. His wife had dragged him to the party so that he could rub elbows with politicians and progressive intellectuals from the region. According to Angela, he should know Congressmen Gustavino and Andrade, the singers Pio Grondona and Gato Alquinta, the painter Carlos Hermosilla, and Bohemian poets from the port, such as Sarita Vial or Eneo Montelo, people who were innovative, creative, and committed to the process. Well-connected as she was, Angela refused to give up on her efforts to help him find work in those turbulent times, hard as it was for a Caribbean such as himself who'd been in Chile for only 2 years. But beneath those almost maternal efforts, Cayetano sensed something else, the desire to attend to an unresolved issue so as to move on to other matters, which perhaps had been postponed only because of the problem at hand. Angela's projects were concerned less with domestic and more with political life, and without a commitment or at least a public standing in the country he'd followed her to, he was a puzzle piece that didn't quite fit. And that's exactly how he felt, out of place and out of the game, at that party where no one would have invited him if it hadn't been for her, and to which he, as he thought with growing crankiness, wouldn't have tried to be invited. He didn't feel like mingling with these VIPs, and was even more reticent to join the circle that had formed around the owner of the most illustrious name, the one most praised, the one surrounded by the most legends. Cayetano, vaguely disillusioned, preferred to withdraw to the library of that turn-of-the-century house, where the siding was renovated with sheets of yellow-painted iron, and which gleamed like a gold coin over the bay. The library, with its wooden floor, exposed oak beams, and shelves full of elegant leather-bound books, offered the refuge of dimness, and, as Cayetano had imagined, was deserted. He settled into a wing chair by the window that led out to the garden, where several guests smoked and talked with complete disregard for the cold, and as he inhaled the intense fragrance of the Pacific, he recalled another sea and another Angela. He remained this way until he lost track of time. Apparently no one missed him. But then, when the Chilean gathering seemed to be occurring in a very distant time and place, or perhaps during a nebulous dream, he heard steps behind him that snapped him out of his modest trance. Someone had entered. Fortunately, this person had not turned on another light. The interloper, like himself, preferred the shadows. Perhaps he also longed for solitude. He stayed still and avoided making any sound. Perhaps the other person had lost his way, or, not seeing anyone, would leave him be. But the steps kept approaching, slowly, as though the feet doubted the very floor they walked on, until they finally stopped close to him.
"How's it going, sir?"
The new arrival's tone was so ironic yet amiable, as if they already knew each other and shared an inside joke, and his greeting so unusual, so personal and affable, that at first Cayetano was too surprised to respond. Since the silence made the isolated phrase seem even more unreal, he searched for a response.
"It's very nice here," he said, "if you're tired of all the excitement."
Remembering the calm rhythm of the man's steps, he thought that he must be older.
"It's perfect for gathering your strength."
Why had he said that, as though inviting him to stay, when he wanted the stranger to leave? At least he didn't turn to look at him and kept his gaze on the horizon through the window. But the other man, whose presence he felt at his back, picked up the thread of conversation.
"It reminds me of Burma, during my youth," he said.
Cayetano asked himself what this cold southern country could have in common with that remote part of Asia that he imagined brimming with heat and rainforests.
"The night of the soldier, a guy far out on the ocean, and a wave."
He spoke as though lost in his own thoughts, but seemed to be describing himself. Where had he come from? The breeze flapped the curtains, and now Cayetano looked out at the waves. He guessed the other man was doing the same.
"A man alone in front of the sea may as well be out at sea."
Cayetano needed to set a limit here.
"Who are you talking about? Aren't you a foreigner?"
The man's use of the casual tu surprised him, but didn't bother him. He wanted to be alone, and yet that voice managed to make him comfortable with its presence.
"When you're far from your country, you have no home, and lose your sense of direction. Back then, I also liked corners like this one."
"And you still like them?"
He sensed that now he was the one to surprise his interlocutor. The man laughed and moved even closer.
"You're right. I still like them."
The atmosphere relaxed. Nevertheless, as though to preserve some distance between them, they avoided looking at each other and kept gazing at the Pacific.
"Now I have various refuges, friends everywhere, and nevertheless, I still sometimes need corners like this one."
"You're Cuban, right?"
He thought the accent must have given him away. He offered a more precise description.
"I'm from Havana." "Then you're Angela Undaraga's husband."
Cayetano suddenly felt naked. The stranger rushed to reassure him, as a friend might.
"Don't be surprised. She's very well known here. Everybody knows she married a Cuban from Florida."
Who exactly was everybody? For the first time, he felt tempted to turn and look at the man. But he restrained himself. After the enthusiastic voyage in which he'd followed his wife's hips to the southern ends of the earth, and after 2 years of false steps, he had learned not to rush.
"The outskirts of Havana," he said cautiously.
The other man laughed.
"You have a beautiful wife, intelligent, innovative. You should feel proud."
That wasn't the way he felt, and this was surely apparent. He took shelter in the distance, in the faraway waves that distracted their gazes, and faked it.
"Yes, people envy me, very much."
They must ask themselves what she couldn't find here that made her go for a man in the north.
This time, the Chilean didn't laugh.
Love troubles are the same in every climate,
he declared brusquely, suddenly somber. An old sadness, dragged through more years than Cayetano could count, seemed quickly to enter the cultivated, amiable voice that had laughed and joked calmly just a moment before. Though he barely paused, when the man spoke again, his voice sounded as if it carried a great weight.
Forgive my frankness, young man, but I know how much it hurts to wear these masks. From the moment I first saw you sitting there in front of the window, far from the garden, where you should be mingling on your wife's arm, I knew what was going on. I've seen too many people grow apart, not to recognize the emptiness that results.
Cayetano himself was now that empty space. His silence was eloquent. His strange interlocutor seemed to have a great deal to say.
At my age, one would think that I've already seen it all, that deceit wouldn't hurt anymore, that betrayal would come as no surprise. But no, on the contrary, all it takes is one push, some unexpected stumble on the path you take each day, and the equilibrium you thought you could count on falls apart. In addition, you lose your reflexes and have less time.
The voice grew low and impassioned at the mention of this threat. Then it rose again.
What burns keeps on burning you, and you don't have anything that can quell it, or even help you to ignore it.
He hesitated.
Nor strength with which to explore it.
He searched for a different ending.
When you're young, despair comes easily, and you immediately think that if someone stands you up, that person will never come again. But this world keeps turning and turning.
Despite the vagueness of this last illusion, Cayetano understood that the man was talking about himself. Nevertheless, he felt that the words he spoke somehow related to him, to Cayetano as well. His intuition told him something.
Are you a writer?
He asked.
You've got the makings of a detective, young man,
the stranger said, half joking.
When you get tired of your profession, you could always hang a sign on the door of some small, cluttered office and wait for someone to hire you for an investigation.
Cayetano couldn't have said whether the man behind him was making fun of him or revealing his destiny. Regardless, he went along with it.
I'll remember that, Mr. Reyes. Ricardo Reyes.
The man seemed to be smiling.
Cayetano, right? What sort of work do you do? These days, whatever comes my way. I'm waiting for work, but after 2 years I'm starting to think that Angela doesn't have such great contacts.
Now, Reyes said nothing. He started to cough. Cayetano froze for a moment, embarrassed that he'd complained about his wife. Something in him reawakened a modicum of manners.
Would you like me to close the windows? Don't worry. The windows have nothing to do with this,
Reyes replied. He cleared his throat, suppressing his cough.
So, you're looking for work,
he went on. At that moment, a woman's high-heeled steps burst into the room.
People are out there asking for you, and here you're hiding like an oyster.
She was an energetic woman with light brown hair.
Let's go because your eel soup is ready and the mayor wants to say some words in your honor. Come on! Come on!
The interruption made Cayetano finally turn around. In doing so, he realized that the man was not at his back, but standing almost next to him. And to his astonishment, he recognized him. During the party, he hadn't dared to approach him, inhibited not only by the tight circle of admirers surrounding him, but also by the authority he attributed to that thick-figured man with his slow movements and whose languid, saurian gaze had roved from the sea to him and then back to the sea during that conversation in which he, Cayetano, had not even deigned to look his way. And now the great poet and distinguished ambassador to France for Salvador Allende was moving away from him, tugged by that woman. He had never been alone with a Nobel laureate before.
Emotion suddenly shook his body, and blood rushed to his head.
What the boss says goes, and she's the boss,
the poet said, and winked. There he went, with his poncho in the Chiloa Island style, the flat cap he always wore, and those cheeks speckled with large moles.
In any case, if you have any free time these days, come see me in my home, La Sebastiana. I have some old postcards from your city, young man. All you have to do is call me.
Cayetano wouldn't have dared make the call. But it was the poet who reached out first, who called his house and asked him to come for a visit. And that was why he found himself here, on Collado Way, and now someone was finally opening that door, with its creaking, rusty hinges and its slats of knotted wood. 3. It was the poet.
Forgive me. I was reading and fell asleep. In addition, Sergio, my chauffeur, is off at the grocery store trying to scrounge something up, and it takes a lot for me to get down the stairs. You'll see that everything here is a bit complicated. Come, follow me, please.
They crossed the minuscule garden of the edifice beside the Maori Theater. Through the bushes, Cayetano glimpsed the city and the squad of soldiers berthed on the breakwater, and beyond that, the Andes. The poet began to climb a staircase, heavily, and Cayetano followed. On the second floor, they went down a hall and continued to ascend, this time on a curved and narrow staircase. Through a porthole, Cayetano could see luminous roofs and shaded passages, as if the house glided over Valparaiso. The poet arrived on the third floor, out of breath. He wore the same cap as before, and on his shoulders a poncho made of fine brown wool. What could he want? What did he need to talk about that would make him invite Cayetano to his home? Cayetano, of all people, a sullen foreigner who had left him on his feet standing and behind him during the only conversation they had ever had, without the slightest consideration for his age, without even a flicker of the admiration, or at least the respect, that everyone else professed for him. The poet guided him to a living room with intensely blue walls and an enormous window that looked out over the entire city. He gestured for Cayetano to sit on a floral print armchair that faced one made of black leather. The room was bright and ample, with a green carousel horse at the center, and next to it stood the dining room, bordered by the same great window. At the other end was a bar with bottles and glasses, a bell, and a bronze sign that read, Don Pablo est ici. Cayetano couldn't help comparing, once again, the hospitality he was receiving with his own social clumsiness, barely corrected during their brief contact over the phone the previous day.
Thank you for coming,
the poet said as he sat down on the leather armchair. Now he seemed to levitate over the belfries of the city.
I'm not going to beat around the bush, Cayetano. You must be asking yourself why I invited you here, and the answer is very simple. Because I think you can help me. More than that, I believe you are the only person in the world who can help me.
Though he had decided to be friendlier during this visit, Cayetano kept his guard up. Please, Don Pablo, don't scare me with so much responsibility, he said. How could someone like me help you?
Let me say that I know some things about you, but I know more about your wife. She's sympathetic to the Unidad Popular government, as I imagine you are as well. In these times, one cannot trust just anyone.
Cayetano examined the poet's swollen hands, large nose, and haggard face. He had a robust complexion, but his shirt collar was too wide on him, as if he had suddenly grown thinner in the past few months. Then he remembered his sudden melancholy and his gloomy illusion to time running short. Only now, among his own things, in the clear light of day that shone in his home, he seemed decisive, enthusiastic, although Cayetano didn't know where the conversation was headed.
I'm Cuban, though by way of Florida,
he said, trying to temper the poet's verve with a dose of humor. I still don't understand.
It's precisely because you're Cuban that you can help me,
Don Pablo cut in. Cayetano adjusted his glasses and stroked his mustache nervously.
Because I'm Cuban?
Let's take this one step at a time,
the poet said, changing his tone.
I see that you haven't stopped looking around this room. First things first. This house is called La Sebastiana, in honor of Sebastian Collado, the Spaniard I bought it from in 1959. For the terrace roof, he designed a great aviary and a landing strip for spaceships.
Now Cayetano feared his leg was being pulled. Are you being serious, Don Pablo?
Completely,
he said, closing his large eyelids circumspectly.
One day, a cosmic Odysseus will make his landing here. Among my four houses, none of them floats like this one. The one in Santiago is hidden in the San Cristobal mountainside. The one on Isla Negra is a beautiful barcarolle, ready to set sail, and Mankell, which was a brick and stone stable, and which I bought with the money from the Nobel, lives lost among the woods of Normandy. But La Sebastiana threads the air, earth, and sea together like a bracelet, Cayetano. That's why it's my favorite house. But it's not as a contractor, but as a poet, that I've called you.
Cayetano was amazed. What did he have to do with poetry? How could he possibly help a famous poet? A seagull soared outside the picture window.
But it's nothing to get nervous about,
Don Pablo added.
One is always less imposing in person than in the newspapers or on television. And also, the years, soon I'll be 70, have begun to take their toll, though they still don't deprive me of the desire to write and to love.
Cayetano wanted to cut to the chase. How can I help you, Don Pablo? The poet was silent, hands folded over his belly, bathed in the metallic late morning light that hardened the facades of houses and the contours of hills.
I need to find someone,
he said, after contemplating for a few moments, gaze lowered.
And someone discreet needs to do the searching. It's a personal matter. I'll take care of all your expenses, and I'll pay you, obviously, whatever you ask,
he specified, watching Cayetano with unease.
You want me to find someone for you?
That's right.
You want to hire me?
And here he remembered what the poet had said to him when they first met.
As a private detective?
Exactly.
But I'm not a detective, Don Pablo.
At least not yet, he added with a faint smile.
Worse, I have no idea how a detective behaves.
The poet's hands picked up some books covered in red plastic from a nearby table.
Have you ever read any Georges Simenon?
A fox-like look tautened his cheeks, increased his forehead.
He's a terrific Belgian writer of crime novels.
No, never, Don Pablo.
He felt embarrassed of his paltry literary knowledge and apologized, as though that ignorance could offend his host.
I'm sorry, I've only read a few novels by Agatha Christie and Raymond Chandler, and of course some Sherlock Holmes.
In that case, it's time for you to read the Belgian,
the poet continued forcefully.
Because if poetry transports us to the heavens, crime novels plunge you into life the way it really is. They dirty your hands and blacken your face the way coal stains engine stokers on trains in the South, where I was born. I'll lend you these volumes, so you can learn something from Inspector Magret. I don't recommend that you read Poe, who invented the crime story and was a great poet. Neither do I recommend Conan Doyle, Sherlock Holmes's literary father. You know why? Because their detectives are too eccentric and cerebral. They couldn't solve even the simplest case here, in our chaotic Latin America. In Valparaiso, the pickpockets would steal their wallets on the trolley, the kids from the hills would bombard them with stones, and the dogs would chase them down alleys with their fangs bared.
This sounded ridiculous. Detective by force, and on top of that, learning the job from crime novels? Anyone he tried to tell about this would immediately call it crazy. And not just call the poet crazy, but him as well.
So, take these books and read them,
Don Pablo added with complete authority, and placed them, not without some difficulty, in a woven bag. One doesn't say no to a Nobel laureate, and much less to a seriously ill Nobel laureate, Cayetano thought, taking the bag. There were 7 volumes, small, not heavy at all, wrapped in red and clear plastic, pleasing to the touch. If he learned something from them, this strange meeting would already be a different kettle of fish. The bag would at least come in handy for picking up his meat ration from the Committee for Supplies and Price, known as JAP, if the meat in fact arrived, since beef and chicken had been gone for several weeks, along with butter, oil, and sugar, and the prices on the black market bordered on abuse.
"Whom do I need to find?"
he heard himself say, as though his voice already belonged to another man.
"I expected nothing less from you, Cayetano," the poet said, and let out a grateful sigh.
He shuffled to the living room door in his slippers to make sure no one was spying on them.
"For that, please listen closely, and I'll try to explain the situation in a few words. 4. I need you to find one of your compatriots, an old friend I lost track of a long time ago,"
the poet said in his calm nasal voice. His eyes gleamed with sudden childlike hope.
"It's been a long time since I've set foot in Cuba,"
Cayetano replied.
"I left the island when I was quite young."
"I'm not so naive as to suppose that you know all your fellow citizens, but the fact that you're Cuban can help you in your task. You'll see. I've thought about this for months, especially since my health began to suffer in Paris. I thought about turning to comrades at the party, including a good friend at the embassy in Havana, but I decided against it, because in days like these, I wouldn't want anything to leak. Politics, you know."
Cayetano Brule looked at the poet. He didn't know what to say.
"You must be asking yourself why I'd trust a stranger," the poet continued. "And the answer is, simply, intuition. When I heard about you recently at a meeting with comrades in this house, I said to myself, he's the one I need. He doesn't know anyone in Chile, so he has no alternative but to be discreet. He's also Cuban, and can visit the island without awakening suspicions. And since he's unemployed, a job like this could come in handy."
"That's why you came to see me in the library the other Sunday, at the party, right?"
"Ecola. Exactly. It was premeditated and calculated."
Cayetano smiled uncomfortably, his hands sweaty, while the poet kept his feet on the white leather footstool, sheathed in woolen socks. It would be difficult to help him, Cayetano thought, but if he didn't at least try, he'd let the poet down, and the man would never speak to him again. It wasn't good to lose a friendship, however nascent it might be, with a poet of such importance. In some ways, the poet, with his melancholy eyes and long sideburns, reminded Cayetano of his own father, a trumpet player in a tropical orchestra, a friend of Bohemians who was affectionate with his family, who had died in the 50s after a concert on a snowy night in the Bronx, where he'd played for years with Xavier Cugat and even the one and only Benny Moray, the barbarian of rhythm, the one who sang Today as Yesterday and danced as if he'd been nursed with conga and bolero instead of milk. After his father's violent death one night on Canal Street, it had become financially impossible for Cayetano's mother to return to the island of Cuba, and she had to make ends meet as a seamstress in Union City.
"What's the Cuban's name,
Don Pablo? If you want to get into the details, you should promise me first that you'll do the work in utmost secrecy."
"You can trust me, Don Pablo. I'll be your own private McGray."
"That's the ticket, young man,"
the poet replied with enthusiasm. He turned toward the bar, with its pink walls and bronze bell, and asked,
"How about a whiskey on the rocks? I mean a good one, at least 18 years old. You should know that I'm the best bartender in Chile. Would you prefer a double or a triple?"
He went to the bar without waiting for a reply. Behind the bar, he picked up a glass, threw in a few ice cubes, and poured generously from a bottle of Chivas Regal. Cayetano thought that this might not be the best way to start his day, since he still had to pick up his canned Chinese pork at the JAP on San Juan de Dios Hill, but he admitted that it wasn't every day that a Nobel laureate prepared such a distinguished drink for a mere mortal and contracted him as a private investigator.
"I can't toast with you because of the treatment I'm receiving at Van Buren Hospital,"
the poet said, lingering over the whiskey's scent before handing it over.
"Although at night, if I'm in the mood for it, I gulp down a glass or two of Oporto without letting my wife, Matilda, see. She'd raise hell if she caught me, but I know there's no better medicine than Oporto. A bit of whiskey can't hurt me, don't you think?"
With the ice cubes clinking in the glass, Cayetano asked himself how he could ever have been aloof with this man.
"As long as you don't go overboard, Don Pablo, it can't do you any harm." "Don't worry, young man. At this age, I'm no longer seduced by excess."
He scrutinized Cayetano's face as he drank. Another gull passed the window with its wings extended and its legs tucked in, moving its head from side to side, cawing an alarm. It glided over nearby roofs and returned to the water, as though indicating the way. Cayetano felt the first sip descend into his core like wildfire. He wasn't accustomed to drinking in the morning.
"How is it?"
asked the poet.
"Superb, Don Pablo,"
was all he could say.
"I've got the touch. A poet who doesn't know his drinks or food is no poet."
Cayetano left the glass on the bar, under a bell that hung on a bronze arm. "So, what's the name?"
"Chivas. Chivas Regal. 18 years.
"No, Don Pablo. What's the name of the Cuban I'm supposed to find?"
"Angel. Dr. Angel Bracamonte."
He stroked the bronze bell. "It doesn't sound familiar at all," Cayetano said, looking at the poet. He thought he saw a flinch of disappointment on his face. But the poet kept on.
"I met him in 1940 in Mexico City when I was consul there. He was an oncologist. He studied the medicinal properties of some plants that the natives of Chiapas used to treat cancer. Bracamonte should be about my age, or maybe older. I lost track of him in 1943, after returning to Chile with Delia del Carril, my wife at the time. He might still live in Mexico."
So the rumors were true. The poet had cancer. At last he could see how the puzzle pieces fit together. Don Pablo, suffering from cancer, was sending him to find the Cuban oncologist for a cure, Cayetano thought, as he polished off the whiskey to embolden himself. The disease explained the poet's exhaustion, his ragged breath, his protuberant ears, and ashen face. Perhaps, Cayetano imagined, he'd never return to his post as ambassador in Paris and would die in his homeland, in Allende's revolutionary nation. He looked out the window in the direction of his own neighborhood, Marina Mercante. His house rose in full view on a hill riddled with yellow walls beneath a washed-out winter sky.
"Pardon me, Don Pablo, but don't you think an ad in the Excelsior would be enough to get Bracamonte on the phone the next day? You shouldn't gamble with your health." "Who said this was a health issue?"
Don Pablo asked, failing to mask the tension on his face.
"Well, since the man's a doctor."
It occurred to him that the poet might want to save face by hiding the motive of the search. He was young, but not naive. There was no such thing as a naive person in Cuba. Idiots and opportunists, certainly, by the thousands, but not naive people. It was clear that the poet needed the oncologist and his plants to win the battle against cancer.
"I'm not looking for him because of my health. He's probably in Mexico. I need you to find him and inform me, but listen closely now,"
he said gravely, pointing at Cayetano with his index finger.
"You can't mention a single word of this to anyone. Not to anyone. Not even to the man himself. When you find out where he is, you should tell only me. Then I'll tell you how to proceed. Understand?"
"Absolutely,"
You should know that it's not easy to trick a poet, much less an ill poet.
So, should I begin my investigation at the Mexican embassy, Don Pablo?
Why go snooping around embassies like some librarian, Cayetano? What you should do is board a plane for Mexico City and start your investigation there. I need you to find Dr. Angel Bracamonte as soon as possible.
5. He couldn't fly to Mexico immediately because there were no available seats. He decided to kill time by leafing through Simenon's novels, which gripped him immediately, with characters who wandered the alleys, bistros, and markets of Paris. He also looked around for people who could tell him a little about the poet, something that went beyond what everybody knew about him, his travels and his loves. If he knew the man better, he'd feel more comfortable, as Neruda had begun to seem like a pretty mysterious guy, concealing facets of his life the way the thick spring fog hid some of Valparaiso's heights. He was cautious about investigating his client's life. Nobody could begin to suspect that he was on assignment. The flame of distrust that burned in his chest made him feel contemptible, but he needed to know the artist through others, using the same method employed by the diligent McGray, who spied without qualms but in great secrecy, even on his most trustworthy informants and closest colleagues. 2 days later, while eating a remarkable seafood dish at Los Porteños in the Cardinal Market near the port, he received an encouraging tip from Pete Castillo, who happened to come into the restaurant for some clams and parsley sauce. A fisherman had just brought those poor man's oysters in a wicker basket. Their elongated shells gleamed like sand on the beach on a clear morning. Pete was a labor union leader who lived in a wooden stilt house in a ravine of Monjas Hill, near Cayetano's home. He had quit the university in his third year, after the triumph of Salvador Allende, to devote himself completely to local political activism, but he still devoured Latin American novels and was a great admirer of Julio Cortázar, Juan Carlos Onetti, and Ernesto Sábado, as well as Jorge Luis Borges, whom he considered a despicable reactionary who just happened to be graced with a magnificent pen.
Neruda isn't among my saints, Pete said in a deep voice as he squeezed lemon with his coarse, dark hands, its juice sprinkling over an open clam, its pink tongue shrinking into the shell in pain. His cantos to Stalin in The Grapes and the Wind and his rejection of the armed approach to building socialism in Chile make him suspect. That poet has gotten too bourgeois.
Stop calling the kettle black and tell me, who can give me more information about him? I mean about his personal life.
Pete thought for a moment.
Perhaps Commander Camilo Prendes could help you.
He sucked the clam's tongue into his mouth, leaving the smooth shell impeccably clean, then washed the delicacy down with a gulp of house white wine.
The commander oversees a brigade of the most radical students from the School of Architecture at the University of Chile, and if memory serves, he has a cousin who's an expert in poetry, an encyclopedia on two marvelous legs, they say. She should know something about Neruda. And anyway, it's never a waste of time to meet a woman like that.
So where can I find this guy?
At the Huck Cookie Factory.
His job is to make cookies for afternoon tea? In times like these?
Cayetano fished a chunk of sea bass out of his soup. It was as white and smooth as the cheeks of princesses in stories by the Brothers Grimm.
Don't make fun of the commander, Cayetano. Prendes means business. Huck is in the hands of workers who are fighting for its expropriation, and he's leading the charge. He's succeeded in expropriating several factories and some country estates under 120 acres in size, despite the opposition of the government. Prendes participated in the Paris uprisings of 68, where he met Daniel Cohn-Bendit, and he also studied in Havana. He's a real threat to the reformists who infest the presidential palace, La Moneda. He's a little bourgeois, too, but he knows his stuff.
Cayetano headed over to Huck that same night. With its illuminated windows and cacophonous machinery, the factory resembled an ocean liner navigating a dense, calm sea, or so it seemed to Cayetano as he approached it through the misty industrial zone. Flags of the Socialist Party hung from the walls, of MAPU and MIR, parties that described themselves as true revolutionaries and dismissed Allende as a mere reformer, as well as canvas signs demanding the expansion of the state's economic power and an end to capitalism. Despite the takeover, the factory continued to operate, although, according to Pete, the shortage of supplies was beginning to take its toll. Cayetano approached the large front door, where a few guards wearing helmets and armed with nightsticks smoked in silence.
"I'm here on behalf of Comrade Pete Castillo," he said, showing them the safe conduct note Pete had scribbled on a paper napkin at the Los Porteños table. "I need to speak with Camilo Prendes."
One of the guards examined the document, jotted Cayetano's information down in a notebook, and after consulting with a superior by phone, allowed him to enter. He felt like something of an orphan as he crossed the empty patio of the factory and approached the office, where another guard handed him a long, flexible bamboo cane.
"Join the group over at the northern access door. Or do you prefer a nunchuck?"
"I've never held one."
"In that case, keep the cane. Carry it like a spear."
He cast him an unfriendly glance.
"And go to the left. They'll give you more instructions at the end of the hall."
At the end of the hall, he encountered a few men with helmets and nunchucks, seated next to a large metal door. They told him that if he saw any suspicious movements, he should knock on the door with a hammer that lay on the floor.
"In case of emergency, everybody knows what to do. Don't worry about finding Commander Prendes. He visits all the sentry posts every night and speaks with all the comrades. Good luck."
They left, taking their makeshift weapons with them, and Cayetano sat down on a stack of boxes and lit a lucky strike. Its aroma gave him solace in the midst of this uncertain night. He was lucky to have gotten these cigarettes from Sergio Puratic, a trader in the port neighborhood, since there weren't any left publicly, and a carton cost an arm and a leg on the black market. He inhaled the smoke slowly, letting it warm his body, and he thought about the poet, the curious mission he'd been charged with, and the stories of Inspector Magret. His life was taking on a surreal slant, yoked to a strange secret that separated him from others. Could he possibly be dreaming? Could this be a dream in which he was waiting, cane in hand, for a revolutionary in a country threatened by the phantom of civil war? Could he be dreaming that he lived in Valparaiso, while actually sleeping 1,000 miles from there, in his old house in Hialeah, near Miami, or perhaps even in Havana itself? His fingers brushed against the Simenon volume he carried in his jacket. He had read a few of the novels in the last few days, not because he thought they could teach him how to be a detective, but because Simenon knew how to tell an entertaining story, and Inspector Magret struck him as both honest and convincing. The book, with its transparent plastic cover folded neatly at the edges, was proof that he'd spoken with Neruda, and wasn't dreaming after all. A vehicle approached the large metal door. Cayetano crushed the cigarette butt with his foot and hid behind a pillar. He didn't want to be seen from outside. It was said that members of the Nationalist Movement for Homeland and Liberty, or of the Rolando Matos Command, shot at the drop of a hat. He held his breath. The paved stones shone in the headlights of a vehicle that slowly approached. At last he saw it. It was a soldier's jeep. Not long ago, the army had shot at workers at a factory they'd taken over.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.